issues with hail this evening. So, never know in Colorado, right? We want to thank everyone again for taking the time to be here and welcome you. This is really an educational forum, and so we have a number of fantastic speakers. They are very, very educated on the topic, and for us, it's an opportunity to come together as a community and make sure that those of us who have been having the conversation for 2 years get an opportunity to meet the people who've only been having the conversation, frankly, for 2 weeks or 2 months. And for all of us to come together and understand what are the activities and the events and the organizations who are already playing a very, very vital role in making change and in working hard to ensure that local voices are heard on this issue. So certainly a committed, educated, and very engaged community that we live in here in Broomfield. The talent and the intelligence and the willingness that people have had to step in has just been incredible. So I'm Jennifer Dulles. I am the founder of Broomfield Concerned, and I'm joined with my co-chair, Jean Lim. And Jean has been one of the people who has really committed she has given countless hours working on these issues in Broomfield over the past 2 years. And if any of you follow us online or follow us on our blogs, Jean is tirelessly working, often putting out that information at 3 o'clock in the morning, before, frankly, a lot of journalists get around to it. So just really, really appreciate the fact that Jean has been so involved in the organization with me. And Jean, if you'd like to just talk a little bit about maybe the organization.
Thanks, Jennifer. For those of you who are not familiar with Broomfield Concerned, we are a coalition of neighborhood groups who are concerned about residential oil and gas development in our neighborhoods. Our goals include educating and creating awareness of oil and gas developments, bringing Broomfield neighborhoods together in a cooperative atmosphere, and sharing what we learn and collaborating with communities outside of Broomfield.
One thing that I would point out is we are an all-volunteer organization, and so we really, really rely on community support and community volunteers. If you have a talent that you can lend, we welcome you being a part of our team and helping us expand our reach even further. So I really would like to thank all the people who have taken time to volunteer with Broomfield Concerned. And speaking of making a community contribution, we'd also like to recognize the elected officials who joined us in the audience this evening. I appreciate seeing faces of city council members here, and we appreciate you coming, hearing more about this topic, spending time with your constituents, and we just appreciate your public service as well. Most important of all, well, we're glad that you've come out tonight, and we'll turn our focus to why you have come. Addressing oil and gas development can be very daunting. It is a dynamic topic, and there are many issues, technical terms, and moving parts to the dialogue. Admittedly, sometimes it can feel difficult to know where to begin. But the most important message of tonight is you are not alone. Your neighbors have been working and learning, and many organizations and groups are involved already. We hope to shed light on some of those groups, those people, and those efforts so that you too can get involved. We have a number of speakers, and we are going to have just a few house rules this evening, and so we'll cover off on just a few of those.
One thing we want to add is, as a nonprofit, we are not endorsing any particular efforts or taking any stances on candidates or initiatives. Our goal is to let you know about some of the efforts that are underway so that you can determine for yourself in an informed manner where you might want to put your time, energy, or maybe even some of your support money. Whatever way you choose to engage in the issue, know that working together can make a difference, and we encourage you to do so.
Rules. Number one, we would ask that you hold your applause until after a speaker has concluded. Like a council meeting, if you want to wave your hands in support, this is fantastic. But if we could just not interrupt them during their valuable time. So applause at the end of their sessions. Number two, we appreciate their time this evening, and we you're speaking. There are a wide variety of opinions on these issues, and your opinion may not coincide with that of one or more of the speakers. We would ask you to, again, just be respectful of that. In fact, I would tell you that not even all of our speakers, this is not a platform, and so our speakers may have varying opinions with regard to different approaches and paths. And the main message tonight is there are a lot of efforts, a lot of strategies, and paths for those people who do have concerns, and we're here to give voice to all of them. Due to time constraints, we're not going to do Q&A during the presentations, but we will have time afterwards where people can come and ask questions of the speakers who stay, and obviously we've got the booths in the lobby. So we also have a professional videographer here tonight, so I would ask that she is the only videographer in the audience. Kim, thank you for doing that. While we do ask you not to record, you're welcome to certainly snap photos on your phone and share those. And speaking of phones, just as we kick off, if you'll take a moment and just silence yours, that would be fantastic. And with that, we'll get started. So our first speaker tonight, we are very, very honored to have Colorado State Representative Mike Foote. Representative Foote has served as a deputy district attorney in Boulder since 2004. In 2012, he was elected to the state legislature to represent the people of Eastern Boulder County. While in the legislature, he has passed dozens of bills into law, including increased penalties for oil and gas environmental violations. He has fought for working families and small businesses, all the while continuing his work as a deputy DA in Boulder. Mike completed his undergraduate degree at Indiana University, received a master's degree from Denver University in International Studies, and a law degree from the University of Colorado. He is an avid cyclist, an outdoor enthusiast. He and his wife Heidi live in Lafayette and have two daughters. In February, Mike announced that he is running to serve as the district attorney of Boulder County, and his robust campaign is well underway. Representative Foote, thank you so much for joining us.
Everybody, thank you very much for inviting me and for having me here. I'll tell you right off the bat, I don't have a PowerPoint. I mean, this picture is great, but I'm not going to go through any slides. And what they told me is I can do PowerPoints. I'm happy to do them, but also as being an elected official for the last 6 years, I can guarantee you I could probably just stand here and talk for 20 minutes. But I hope that what I talk about is valuable, and as was said before, I'm happy to stick around at the end and take any individual Q&A after the program is done. I'll give you a little bit of background so that you know where I'm coming from, and then go into a little bit of the landscape of the state. I first ran for the state legislature, and I started in 2011. And one thing I heard when I got down to the legislature, which is actually very true, is that sometimes you pick the issues you deal with, and sometimes the issues pick you. And when it comes to the oil and gas issue, I would say the latter is very correct, at least for me. When I first started running in 2011, the city of Longmont, which is in my district, my house district, was adopting some new regulations. And during that time, they adopted some new regulations. They didn't go as far as some people wanted, but they went a lot farther than the industry wanted. So the industry sued. And in the midst of that lawsuit, a citizens group got together and decided that they were going to put on the ballot for the city a prohibition against fracking, period. And I think many of you know the rest of the story. That passed 60-40 in 2012. And you may or may not know, but Longmont is not nearly as blue of a city as the city of Boulder. Longmont is quite a purple city. And for something to pass 60-40 means that it had Democratic support, it had unaffiliated support, and it had Republican support. And so the city of Longmont passed that in 2012, litigation ensued. I think many of you know that since then, the Fort Collins case and the Longmont case was announced by the Supreme Court, which said that a 5-year moratorium and a outright fracking ban was found to be against state law. It was preempted by state law. It's not that it's unconstitutional necessarily, I think that's important. Maybe Dan will talk about that a little bit later, but it's against state law, it's preempted by state law. So Anyway, that's been happening during the time that I've been a state representative down in the Capitol. And of course, the folks in Longmont, just like people here in Broomfield and the folks in Lafayette, have been very concerned about oil and gas development. So it's been a big issue of mine, and I've run a number of bills. I have to say, unfortunately, many of my bills have not passed, and I'll talk to a little bit about the dynamics of that. One that did pass in 2014 was a bill that increased penalties on oil and gas violations. That actually was the second year we ran that bill. I ran it first when it was one of my first bills introduced in 2013 to increase penalties. It didn't pass the first year, but it finally passed the second year. And I think part of the reason was that the governor and the Oil and Gas Conservation Commission and even the industry was so embarrassed at how low the penalties could be that they finally gave in and allowed us to pass this bill. Because the penalties had not been increased since the Eisenhower presidency, if you can believe that. So it was basically, the penalties were so low, it was pretty much the equivalent of a parking ticket for any kind of violation. So we did that, we got it passed, and that's great. But I'll tell you that for the 6 years I've been down there, really my experience down at the state level is that the oil and gas industry is in the driver's seat at the state. They are. The laws are very favorable to them, and it hasn't been an overnight phenomenon, but it's been the course of many years where this law has been tweaked a certain way, this law has been tweaked a certain way, the interpretation of the laws have been tweaked a certain way, and then also it really comes down to how they're administered as well. The governor and who the governor appoints to the Colorado Oil and Gas Conservation Commission and to a lesser extent the Department of Public Health and Environment really do matter in these cases. Right now in the Colorado Oil and Gas Conservation Commission, you may know that they don't deny permits. The oil and gas industry goes to the commission, they ask for a permit to drill, the commission doesn't deny it. Now, sometimes they go back and say, well, go back and try it again so we can approve it when it comes back the next time. This isn't right or that isn't right. So it's not entirely fair to say that they just always rubber stamp it, but they don't deny it. They come back, the industry will come back and they'll resubmit a permit based on the feedback they get from the Colorado Oil and Gas Conservation Commission. Then, after the state grants the permit, it goes to the city or the county to then decide what they're going to do with that particular permit. And there's probably not enough time to get into all the intricacies of preemption and the kinds of powers that the city councils or county commissions have or they don't have. And my theory on that is the city councils and county commissions actually have quite a bit of power. Some are afraid to use it, some aren't. But this has been the real conflict between local governments and between the oil and gas industry is what kind of power can be used. When it turns out that city councils or county commissions go a little bit farther than what the industry wants, then we see a lot of lawsuits, and that's what we've seen over the last several years, unfortunately. But going back to the state system, we have a system that's set up that is quite favorable to the industry, and I don't think that many people really would deny that, even if you talk to industry representatives behind the scenes. Of course, there are regulations and that have been put into place to try to ensure that things don't go bad, and those have to be followed or penalties are assessed. But the bottom line, at least in my opinion, is that if you have a company that wants to come in and they want to drill, even if it's close to a school or even if it's in a residential neighborhood, it's an uphill battle with the state in order to keep that from happening. That doesn't have to be how it is, but right now, that's how it is. Now, it also doesn't mean that cities and counties can't push back, and people can't push back with initiatives, and I'll get into that in a couple of minutes. There have been some changes over the course of the last 6 years since I've been down there. There have been a lot of attempts, and I can go over some of my bills very briefly, but there have been a lot of attempts. There have been some changes. I mentioned that the fines bill ultimately passed. There was a bill that ultimately passed this year. Your state representative, Matt Gray, passed this bill based on, it deals with forced pooling, and it makes the system a little bit better, at least a little bit better for those that are being forced pooled. So those kinds of things happen. But anything that I've run over the last several years that has been designed to change the system to make it more fundamentally equal between cities and people and the industry has failed. For example, I ran a bill a couple of years ago that would, in my opinion, it basically reasserted the local government's ability to exercise local control over siting of oil and gas facilities. Now, local governments have the ability to site all kinds of things. That's one of their main basic functions, is to cite what happens with land use in their communities. If you want to put a factory somewhere, if you want to put houses somewhere, other businesses somewhere, local governments, that's their bread and butter. They cite these things based, of course, upon the opinions of their community. And so what I wanted to do is put oil and gas on the same level as every other land use. And we called it local control for oil and gas, just like you can for hard rock mining, just like you can for aggregate mining, just like you can for everything else. Well, long story short, that bill failed, and there's been subsequent efforts to run that, and that has also failed. So that was an effort to try to change the system a little bit that the industry fought back against and unfortunately won. Now, like I said, it doesn't have to be this way. And one thing that I would encourage you to do over the course of not only this election but going forward is to make sure that this is an issue that you ask candidates about up and down the ballot, from your city council to your governor candidates and everywhere in between. Ask them specifically about what they think about local control, what they think about the role of oil and gas, what they think about where oil and gas should be allowed to be, if at all. And what you may hear, and hopefully you can kind of work through and ask additional questions, is a lot of times people that are running for office talk about we need to find an appropriate balance. You'll hear that all the time, and I would encourage you to go beyond that, because what that means is, in my opinion, status quo. Balance, well, the way it works out, the way that people talk about it, is the industry is allowed to drill. And there may be a little pushback here and there, but the bottom line is they get to put their facility 1,000 feet away from a school. Or they get to put their facility in the middle of a neighborhood, even after some resistance. And so if we get candidates that ultimately win office that don't believe in this so-called balance, then I think progress can be made. If we elect a governor that is more interested in really enforcing, not only enforcing the laws that we have, but also making sure that the industry is called to account if they mess up, and also just putting a little bit of common sense into what's going on in the state, I think that can matter tremendously. Have a Colorado Oil and Gas Conservation Commission that will actually say no sometimes. Have a Colorado Department of Health and Environment that will say no sometimes. I think that's important. And also have a state that, instead of suing local governments for asserting their local control, actually trying to work with local governments and putting a little more common sense in what we can do. So all of that is possible. It just hasn't happened over the last several years because of the folks that have been in power in the state. Not everybody. We have a House of Representatives that have passed many of these bills that I think can make a difference. But the state Senate has killed many of those. And so it matters who's in the legislature, it matters who's in the governor's seat, and it matters who's in your city council and county commissions and other areas. And it matters in many ways, but make sure to really kind of dig in and get their views on it, and make sure that they're willing to, at least from the city level, push back against the state, and make sure that at the state level, they're willing to listen and accede to more local control on this issue. And that's not the only kind of fronts that we can push back on. Of course, having the right people in office is important. There are ballot measures that are on the ballot pretty much every year from a local level. Obviously, you're all familiar with 301 last year. I'm very familiar with it. And there's local level ballot measures and there's state level ballot measures. One that may get on the ballot this year is a 2,500 foot setback rule, which is much higher than what we have now. Right now, we have a 500 foot setback from houses and 1,000 feet setback from things like hospitals and apartments and schools. So if they get enough signatures this year, that will be on the ballot as well. There's a lot of things you as citizens can do, and I think it can help change the system, but it's going to take some time and perseverance. And to that end, I don't know how much more time I have, actually. But okay, very good. To that end, I want to just extend my thanks to some folks in this room that I recognize that have actually helped us try to bring about this change down in the Capitol, and also what you've done here in Broomfield as well. It does matter. I think that we get some feedback sometimes. People come down to the Capitol and the bill that they're advocating for doesn't pass, and perhaps what they see is state senators fiddling on their phone the entire time while you're testifying. And of course, I apologize for that. That's unfortunate. And sometimes it may seem like the panel's not listening. And sometimes, admittedly, there's folks that may not be listening. But it takes perseverance, it takes effort, and it takes a lot of work to change a system like we have in place. We didn't get here overnight. We've had many of the laws in place since the 1970s. And they've been continually updated and tweaked over the course of time to make it more favorable to the industry. So we're not going to get away from where we are overnight. But I can guarantee you one thing. If people don't come down to the Capitol, if bills aren't run, if people aren't pushing back at city councils, if city council members aren't pushing back against the state, none of that's going to change. Right now, status quo is the way that the industry likes it. And we have to push back on multiple fronts, including legal fronts, which you're going to hear about a little bit later on, in order to change the status quo. So I realize I'm a little bit almost out of time here. As I said, I'm happy to take questions. I'm happy to talk further offline about this issue. I just think it's very important for us to keep at it. And I know that your state representative is doing it. I know that folks up in Boulder County are doing it and other places. It has to be a concerted effort, an effort that takes some time, but I'm confident that we can turn it around given all the effort and people like yourselves. So thank you again for having me. I really appreciate it.
Number of bills, I think, that have been introduced by Representative Foy that are very, very meaningful in terms of backing up the distance from the playgrounds. Stuff like that, it feels common sense, yet we're still struggling at the state level. So I would encourage the people who are in this room, follow LOGIC, which is the League of Oil and Gas Impacted Citizens. And they also make people aware of when certain initiatives are happening at the State House, when certain bills are coming up. And this next legislative session, take the opportunity to come down. It really, really matters when we have local Broomfield folks there. And we have a bit of a reputation now for showing up down at the State House. We want to continue that into the next session. So, Mike, thanks again. Appreciate it. Our next speaker is Heidi Henkel. And Heidi is a 10-year resident of Broomfield and is the founder of Broomfield Moms Active Community, which is a nonpartisan group that focuses on protecting our most vulnerable populations, both locally and statewide. Mothers in this group reveal what life is like at the Capitol as concerned citizens and give hope to those who feel helpless and education to those who want to understand the ways our state is and isn't protecting our most vulnerable populations. In following the past year of legislation, she has witnessed bills that, for instance, would protect kids on their playground from oil and gas operations get killed in our Senate committees. So she has decided it is her mission this year to support Colorado Rising, which is a ballot initiative that defines 2,500-foot setbacks for oil and gas away from our schools, homes, water sources, and vulnerable areas. She serves on their advisory board, engaging audiences who are willing to be educated on the science behind the initiative, as well as the true necessity behind it as it seeks to protect families and land from future oil and gas developments. Heidi, if you'll come to the stage, thank you so much. Heidi Henkel with Colorado Rising.
When fracking comes to a city, it puts our health and safety at risk. With over 1,200 peer-reviewed research articles, the harmful effects of fracking are well documented, including including increased risks of asthma, birth defects, and cancer. Currently, in Colorado, fracking wells can be as close as 150 feet from a home. That is less than half a football field. Aside from the health and safety issues, it's loud, unsightly, and terrible to live next to. This is an effort to increase the buffer zone between new fracking wells and our homes and schoolyards to 2,500 feet. We love our neighbors. Let's keep them safe. Don't frack with Colorado. Our health, our safety, our home.
Awesome. Thank you for watching that video. It's a brand new video that came out, and this actually came out from a very small group out of Lafayette, and they are just concerned citizens, and they wanted to help support the ballot initiative. Again, my name is Heidi Hinkle, and I'm a mom, and I used to teach high school and science, and so I enjoy talking about the science about fracking and so on. So my first slide is just to talk and to tell you about a new ballot initiative coming up in 2018. It's ballot initiative number 97. It's something that's going to be very important. Some topics I'll cover tonight is just sometimes when we talk about fracking, people don't actually understand what it is. So I don't want to assume that you know what fracking is. I'm going to go a little bit into it. After that, I'm going to show you some health and safety effects. And then some more information on our ballot initiative, what has been done so far, and what is different in 2018. And then I'm going to go through just a few ways that you can help. So as I'm going through this, I want you guys to actually take out your phones. And if you have a, you know, take a picture option, obviously a lot of you guys have smartphones, and you guys want to take pictures of any of these slides, I would encourage you. So we all know how lucky we are to live in Colorado. I've lived here most of my life. My husband was in the military. We traveled a lot, and then we came home. We love to value our land, our water, our wildlife, and our famous clear blue skies. And right now, it's at risk of fracking. And right now, our air quality is graded at level, what grade? Do you guys know? You know, at Adams 12 School, they do a 1, 2, 3, 4, so you're about right. It's an F, yeah. So it's a low grade air quality. So first of all, what fracking is what they do is they drill into the ground. And a lot of my neighbors did not know I live in McKay Landing. They did not know that if something is just a few miles away, that it actually goes underneath their home. They said, oh my gosh, I had no idea that that's what fracking does. And so this is very exciting to know and to actually teach people, yeah, they can go for miles underneath the ground. I have a driver. What they do is when they inject things into the ground, I'm going to keep it really simple for you. They put in water and they put in chemicals into the ground that are known for causing cancer. Generally, anything that ends in ene, xylene, benzene, those are all carcinogenic. Anytime you hear the word carcinogenic, that is cancer causing. What it does is they put it underneath the ground in high pressure and they break apart the rock. And what happens is gas comes out of there at a high pressure. And also, the chemicals leave a residual area down into the ground, and this is from miles away, and then it comes back out. Doing this requires a ton of water. So millions of gallons of water are permanently destroyed. And sometimes I'm going to have to read off my list because it's facts. So 2 to 12 million gallons of water per frack are trucked in and mixed with toxic chemicals and sand. Actually, we waste about $4.6 billion a year. Along with natural gas, the fracking fluid comes back to the surface and is disposed of either at a treatment plant or injected back into the ground. Now, there's two ways really to frack. You can actually put that water back into the ground. That's what's known as injection wells. And that happens in Oklahoma, where you hear about all the earthquakes. Now, we fought here in Broomfield not to have these injection wells, which is great, but Weld County is littered with them. And if they have an earthquake up there, we're going to feel it down here. I also wanted to mention, too, that during that process, a lot of that water is not put back into the hydrologic cycle, meaning we can't use it again. Another thing, too, is that the Clean Water Act does not apply to fracking. After the gas is let up out of the ground, it's collected and it's stored on the surface, and then they transport the gas. One of the biggest things that people don't realize, though, is that when we have this gas and we transport it, we get it up out of the ground, it costs us actually just as much in carbon emissions as coal. So when we say, well, we're not coal anymore, natural gas is no better. And actually, a lot of scientists will go on record and say it's actually worse than coal. And so in Colorado, we have approximately 80,000 wells that have been drilled. And so here's just a few facts. Like in Weld County, just northeast of Denver, over 20,000 fracking wells have gone up. It's one of the highest concentrations in the country, not just in Colorado, in the country. There are about 80,000 active oil and gas wells operating in Colorado, making us the fourth highest in the nation. And I want to reiterate, too, that the reason why they frack is because we live on something called shale. So that's why people say you live on shale. That's why they frack, because that's where they get the gas from. So I could go on and on about all of these, but just really quickly, the environmental dangers of fracking, after the wells are drilled, those are permanent. It's not like the earth heals itself. And so what happens is we have leakage under the ground, and actually in the first year, they're known to leak at least 6%. And then after that, they leak further and further and further. And oftentimes we don't know that they leak until they get into our water systems. We also have leaks on the ground level itself. We have runoff, we have spills as well. This one was heartbreaking for me, and I cried last night actually developing these slides. I hear a lot from Erie residents that have nosebleeds, and they keep saying that not only do my kids have nosebleeds, but I have nosebleeds as well. And they're very common near oil and gas well pads due to all the toxins in the air. And what's been happening is that the kids go to school and they don't just have Kleenexes anymore. They have to upgrade to paper towels because just the Kleenexes themselves are not enough. We also have a ton of health effects of fracking. Over 200 peer-reviewed studies, and they keep coming in. We have a lot more studies here in Colorado as well. Studies are showing increased rates of cancer and lung disease within half a mile of wells. And I also want to reiterate that a lot of these studies, in fact, almost all of them, I want to believe, are not even recognized by the industry. Fracking harms babies. Among babies who live in oil and gas well pads, there's a 25% lower birth weight, and children are up to four times more likely to get childhood leukemia, which is environmentally induced. It's inconceivable, too, to do any tests on these people while they're pregnant. So you'll hear the industry say, you know what, why don't we test this in Colorado? We don't know why anyone would want to purposely put pregnant women around oil and gas wells and around benzene and things that cause cancer. And all of those things that I mentioned are things that aren't like the fantastic things, right? But I want you to understand that the cancer-causing elements, all of our toxins in our air and our ground are super important. This is the general idea. In the past year, though, we've had 14 explosions in the past year. Several are fatal. You guys have heard of Firestone. You guys have heard of a lot of the ones that happened nearby. There's been 14 explosions, injuring multiple people and killing several. The tragedy in Firestone, just 30 miles north of here, killed two men and critically injured the mother, whose child was also in the house. Other blasts in Meade and Windsor, Colorado, has killed and seriously injured multiple oil workers. And between 2006 and 2017, there were 136 fires and explosions in Colorado related to oil and gas development. So clearly the regulations are not working. If this were an airline, would you want to ride on it? Thanks, that's my daughter, she said no. And there's been no charging of any environmental crimes of any of these, by the way. So what do our current setbacks look like? Well, as you can tell right now, they're very close to that school. So that's a fracking site. And I was in the legislative session where a lot of people did not approve of moving oil and gas sites, even away from the playgrounds. Oil and gas just says we want to be 1,000 feet away from the schools. Playgrounds, we can be as close as we want to. And so that's what we tried to fight, and that was also killed in the Senate. And so our setbacks are, our setbacks are 500 feet from homes and 1,000 feet from schools and hospitals and large occupancy buildings. Why do we have only 500 foot setbacks? Well, they're antiquated laws, that's just what it is. These setbacks were only designed for those single vertical wells and noise ordinances. not these major industrial fracking sites that include a lot of environmental and health impacts. And they can go for miles under the ground now, so wouldn't you think they should be just further away? So would you like to know how you can protect Colorado?
Yeah.
Yeah? Awesome. Very cool. Let's switch. The way that we can protect Colorado, first of all, we did try in the legislature. I was in the room during the Senate hearing where we talked about elevating the health and safety above oil and gas operations, and they went on the record saying we just simply cannot afford that. And that bill was killed. That was their only reasoning. I want to reiterate that. That was their only reasoning. I've gone to the COGCC. That's my next slide. And we can't depend on them either. They listen to hours of comments, and we get head nods, understand, and then they, like Mike Foote said, they pass it along, and no permits have ever been denied. The one thing, though, that we can depend on is us. That's you, me, everyone else. And so when I ask people, are you for the setbacks? Are you for the 2,500-foot setbacks? I ask not only for it, but can we pass along the word? So our greatest hope is what we call Colorado's initiative process. In 2016, we came very close to qualifying two ballot measures, and in that process, we learned how to win an initiative and do better this time. Why are we better prepared to win in 2018? We have more time to collect signatures that are focusing on one ballot instead of two. We are working with an experienced gathering firm with a long history of success. We've built a broad coalition of local, state, and national allies. I'll show you our endorsements here in a few minutes. And we are far better organized. We're using top-notch online tools, Snowflake model for developing statewide movement building, volunteer development and engagement, and a lot of fundraising. So our mission is to protect Colorado's health, public health, safety, air, land, quality of life, and the people that we love. So in 2018, Colorado Rising is pursuing a statutory initiative instead of a constitutional one. Statutory means that our legislators can modify it. I'm sure you guys have heard of constitutional amendment. That's like Tabor. That's something that we want to try to avoid a lot of times because it permanently changes our constitution. So our initiative is 2,500-foot buffer zones between new oil and gas fracking operations and occupied buildings like homes and schools and vulnerable areas like playgrounds and water sources. Another reason we're going to win, though, is the people of Colorado favor increased setbacks. And if this affects Republicans, unaffiliated, Democrats, it doesn't matter. Polling indicates the majority of voters across the political spectrum would vote for this setback. And we have to get the right people in office to keep it there. Now, Colorado Rising cannot officially endorse anyone, but we will tell you who has endorsed us. And so I just highlighted a few, but I do want you to take a screenshot picture of this, if you would, so that you would look at our endorsement page. Joseph Salazar, he's running for Attorney General. Mike Foote, who just spoke, and Mark Williams, also running for Congress in the CD2 region. There's a lot of endorsements on there, and some people don't even have their picture up yet, so make sure you scroll all the way down. Lots of groups, lots of elected officials. I do want to remind you, though, that oil and gas is also trying to pass their own initiative that will change our constitution. I love that commercial because it's kind of funny because they look like an orbit, like, you know, there's going to be like some sort of sparkle coming out. But be leery of anything sponsored by Vital for Colorado. You can take a screenshot of this one, too. CRED, Protect Colorado, they're attempting to put items on the ballot that are very damaging. Will amend our constitution if passed. Oil and gas, I want to remind you, will spend millions of dollars, so the rule of thumb, all the big commercials, the big ads are usually sponsored by the people who have all the what? Money and the power. So some Mythbusters, is this a ban? No, it's not. There's still 34% of Colorado's land not included in this. A lot of people say, aren't you thankful for your car, fuel, and plastic? Well, things are changing. Weren't we thankful for outhouses back then? Yes, but we're also even more thankful for indoor plumbing. And this just is gonna take time. It's gonna take money to move forward with this. They say you're taking away our jobs. Actually, roughly 50% of the jobs reported by the industry are gas attendants, and a lot are non-residents who are working in oil and gas. And then they say, wouldn't we lose money? No, we're actually losing money already with oil and gas. past. And if you want to talk further about that afterwards, I'd love to talk to you in the lobby about that. So while we'll win, our most powerful resource, like I said, are people like you who don't want our communities fracked. Like you said, you have to be active at the state capitol, at your city council meetings. So what we need to win is 145,000 signatures statewide. We need 400,000 by August 6th, and we need educated voters for the initiative and for those running for office who promise not to go against the will of the people once it's passed. We have no gubernatorial candidate yet that has endorsed the setbacks yet, so I encourage you to ask them what will they do after they're passed. How you can contribute, you can gather signatures. I want you guys to look at this list and just figure out what is you. Are you a great person to help host a party? Are you a great letter writer? So take a picture of this and figure out how you want to contribute. You want to help fundraise, staff a table at events, do a lot of backseat efforts. And I love that picture with like the little fish attacking the big fish, because that's kind of how we feel with David and Goliath. And it's true, it's very true. So at the end of tonight, we want you to complete the sign-in form and choose a volunteer activity. Sign a petition outside, as long as you're a Colorado registered voter. Donate if you're able to, and then join a local signature collecting team or create one. You can just at least collect 40 signatures for us. We'd love to have you. And then take a screenshot of this really quick. This is my last slide. If you want to join us, that's our website, coloradorising.org. That's my name. That's my email. You can also friend me on Facebook. I go down a lot of times and listen to people, and I will do a Facebook Live of what their speech is about. So gubernatorial candidate, things like that. I will record, and I'd like to pass that on. Thank you.
Heidi, thank you so much. You are an incredible asset to our community, and we are so happy. Our next speaker is Kevin Krieger, and he is a Brimfield City Council member and one of our very, very best advocates on City Council, incredibly appreciated. Councilman Krieger was first elected to the Brimfield City Council in 2015. He moved to Brimfield in 2003 and is married to Mila Sabroka. They have four children. Kevin received a Bachelor of Science degree in chemistry from Roosevelt University in Chicago. And he assists manufacturing and software companies in implementing quality assurance programs that ensure consistent, high-quality products. His extensive community involvement includes coaching girls soccer, mentoring and tutoring disadvantaged youth, serving on the supervisory committee of a community financial credit union, and volunteering at his kids' schools. Kevin enjoys hiking, skiing, camping, and other outdoor activities. He has been a leading advocate on our city council for prioritizing health and safety and assuring the protection of our environment. Councilman Krieger, thank you again for being with us. And so please join us.
Hello, everybody. Thank you very much for being here. I'm Kevin Krieger. Before I start, I'd like to acknowledge a couple other city council members who are here. Devin Schaff right here, if you could stand up. Diane Castriata is right there, thank you. Ben Erickson, I saw. Benny is back here, thank you very much, Benny. Are there others that I cannot see? Okay. Really, I do appreciate you being here on Friday night. It shows how engaged you are in your community and how much you care about important topics like this. So Mila and I set aside a date night at least every other week, and this is it. So, shows you what a romantic I am. These are the topics that I'm going to talk about. I just kind of want to lead you through these. I will be available after also for some question and answer, and really, as an elected official representing you, always available. By phone, text, and email, and I can give you contact information afterwards. It's also online. So let's talk about our current state. So most of you here are familiar with Extractions Project. This is the big project that we really have been dealing with for the last couple of years now. There are other operations in Broomfield, but I'm going to focus a bit on this since it's the biggest one that we're currently working with. There is another operator moving forward and possibly another one that follows. So Extraction's plans currently are to drill 84 wells on 6 different pads. The Livingston pad is one of the closest to the Anthem Highlands, Anthem Ranch, and Wildgrass neighborhoods. The other pads that you see there are along the Northwest Parkway, and I'm going to show you a map, but largely between Broomfield and unincorporated Adams County, in Broomfield actually, but between our residences and unincorporated Adams County. Also, Advanced Extraction plans to plug and abandon 41 older wells as a part of this project. So this map, which maybe isn't high enough resolution for a screen this size to be easily seen, but the major roadway right down there is the Northwest Parkway. This is the Livingston pad. It's right next to Lowell. And this is where Sheridan comes up. 144th would be right around here, maybe a little lower. Sheridan comes up here and curves, and Sheridan crosses Lowell right there. So that's the corner of Anthem Highlands. That's Anthem Ranch. Again, this is the Lowell pad, 19 wells. And then going left to right, these pads have 8 wells, 8 wells, 16 wells, 16 wells, and 17 wells. Plenty, none drilled yet. Okay. So in our current state, we do have a contract with Extraction. Many of you that have been following this know it was approved last October. It was an extraordinarily contentious vote. It was certainly not a unanimous vote. It was actually a 6-4 vote, so it was just about as close as you could get. I did not vote for that contract. Betty Erickson did not vote for that contract. Guileen and Devin were not on council at the time, but have made it extremely clear they would not have voted for that contract. It does include some best management practices that go above and beyond what the state requires, so that is a good thing. It required a tremendous, tremendous effort in terms of negotiating and pushing and threatening and pressuring. I do not want this project in Broomfield, so while it does include best management practices that go above the minimal state requirements, it is not enough for me personally to be comfortable with in residential areas next to homes, playgrounds, schools, and drinking water reservoirs. Thank you. Extraction also needs state approval. So the Livingston pad is due for an administrative approval, which means an approval without a public hearing, possibly by the end of this month. We're not sure what date they would likely do that. And it could be delayed beyond this month, but right now it's looking likely that it would be sometime by the end of this month. The other 5 pads that I talked to you about are currently scheduled to be reviewed in June 11th and 12th. There is word that those could be delayed until their July hearings, but those are coming up soon. COGC, could you go back? COGCC, okay, the Colorado Oil and Gas Conservation Commission that has already been talked about, a regulator in quotes only, has, as you heard, never denied a permit yet. Things are changing a little bit, and I must say, just to be completely honest with you, that I expect them to approve this because that is their track record. But this has been more difficult for them. In the past, fracking has been 1 well, 2 wells, maybe 4 wells on a pad, and generally in rural areas where somebody wants them to come onto their land and drill because they're going to make a lot of money. Now these operators, a couple of them at least, like Extraction, are going right into residential areas, right in neighborhoods, and they are not invited, and it causes an uproar. And this uproar is helpful. And in fact, Extraction could be the best advocate that we have for getting this out of residential areas. Because while they are one of the companies that is most adamant about getting it into residential areas, they are making so many thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people so angry that there is a rising tide of people that don't want this in residential areas. And it's because of companies like Extraction that, honestly, the momentum has grown so big. So more on the current state. The city of Broomfield working on new oil and gas regulations. A lot of you are aware of this. These regulations are similar to the best management practices in Extraction's contract. There are some differences. So again, the regulations don't go far enough to make me comfortable with this in our city, but this is the current state and something important for you to be aware of. In these regulations, we need to balance what's in our authority and what isn't in our authority. And what is unclear. And And that's a difficult balance, and you get different opinions from different people. It's not just one of us who is writing these regulations. And so this is a very actively discussed subject among city council and staff. The regulations have to address health and safety concerns, obviously, in addition to that, community impacts that can happen. But this is really the most important thing. Noise and other types of community impacts are very disruptive, but really health and safety is so far above that. That's what it's absolutely all about. There is a study session. We have looked at these regulations once, and there was a vote, a non-unanimous vote, that did pass them on first reading. We're going to go into a study session and discuss some more. Many, many, many other conversations happening. And then we will have a second vote. The second time, if the city council, we vote twice to pass this, this has to be passed on two readings, it's called, then they will become ordinances. Again, it's passed on the first reading. We're going into a study session open to the public. This is a Wednesday evening. The public can't all participate in this, but you can come watch, and you can kind of figure out what people are thinking by council member comments. I welcome you. I would ask you to please come. So now I want to transition. That's where we are now. I want to transition to how we got here. Where have we been? So Extraction bought 26 wells spread over 10 different pad sites. Okay, and a pad site is just a collection of wells. It's got some common infrastructure associated with it. So 26 wells on 10 pad sites. They approached the city in 2016, and they said, hey, we want to consolidate on the 3 pad sites. Consolidate, 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 over and over and over. Consolidate these 26 wells. Consolidate these 26 wells. Consolidate these 26 wells to 3 different pads. It would be further from homes. Newer and less unsafe technology. And a couple less wells. They were going to turn 26 wells into 24 wells because there's more efficient ways of extracting the minerals. They told me this personally in an open study session. I asked them extremely clearly and then reiterated exactly what the well count was going from and to. And it was going from 26 wells to 24 wells. Then they filed applications with the state for 141 wells on 4 pads. Yeah. Even right now, I can barely talk about this because it makes me so angry. Obviously, a giant uproar from the community and a giant uproar from many elected officials. People wanted to know what the heck was going on. There was an incredible amount of negotiation that happened. One of the significant things that the city did was create a task force made up of 12 members and 2 alternates. People with a variety of views across the spectrum on the oil and gas industry and whether residential drilling is okay or not. And they came up with recommendations that the city council then voted on, and you know, for many of them, not all of them, they are in the current regulations that we're looking at right now, okay, that we're considering putting into law here in Broomfield. So the oil and gas task force was a big thing. I want to talk about the negotiation. When this happened, and there was an uproar, Extraction said, okay, we miscommunicated with you. But the guy that's leading this project that miscommunicated with you, we're going to move him to another project, so don't worry about that. We're going to get you a different lead person to negotiate with. And what I said at the time was, this is like you're going to buy a house, you're going to have a house built, and the builder says it's going to be this many square feet, it's going to cost this much money. And you're like, yeah, cool. Let's do that. This many square feet, this much money, you sign a contract. And then all of a sudden they say, well, it's going to be half that square feet, and it's going to be twice the money. And you say, no, it's not. Absolutely not. That's a ripoff. I'm not letting that happen. And they say, okay, we're going to move that real estate agent you were working to another project. We're going to get a different real estate agent. We're going to negotiate with you. And we're going to start negotiating at the house with half the square feet and twice the money. And we're going to negotiate from there and see how close we can get to making us both happy. That's what this has been like. It's a scam. Next slide, please. Oh, sorry, no, please go back. So where this got us is here. The current contract that we have, the one that was approved in October, for 84 wells on six pad sites, and those were the pad sites that I showed you. So that's where we stand currently with extraction. I'm going to go over some pros that people give us. There are some people that want this to move forward. I'm going to represent both sides of this issue, and I'm going to tell you what those people have told us. I'm going to give you my opinions on it. We don't have a lot of people that come to us wanting this to move forward, but there are a few. And actually, I was remiss in not saying something before about the negotiations and the pressure on extraction. There is almost nothing that was more valuable during that time period than the residents of Broomfield rising up and pressuring council and pressuring extraction, forming neighborhood groups, putting up websites, putting together complex communication tools, putting out newsletters. I mean, like, professionally run operations, all volunteer. It's unbelievable. Makes me proud, and that's been a giant value. So please join in that effort if you can and if you would like to. So one of the pros we hear about is jobs. It's a job creator. Heidi Hankel talked about the fact that it's not as much of a job creator as they say. Frankly, none of the people that are drilling these wells live in Brookfield. There are some gas and oil executives, upper management that lives in Brookfield. Okay. The people that are drilling the wells, I mean, it's not that they can't live in Brookfield, but the truth is, our home prices have become a bit expensive and they're just really not living here. We're not creating Broomfield jobs. We're not putting a bunch of Broomfield people to work. The other thing is, extraction has access to two drilling rigs that they lease. They don't own them. And if they don't put them on our pads, they'll put them on the next project. So these people aren't going to be fired. They're just going to be put on a different project. I don't see any benefit personally to Broomfield, the community I represent, in terms of jobs. Next, please. Energy independence. People say this all the time. Don't you want to be energy independent? Don't you use natural gas? Yes, both. I want to be energy independent, I use natural gas. We are energy independent when it comes to natural gas since 2016, since November of 2016. And we also have energy independence when it comes to oil. The gas and oil that they are going to drill, that they want to drill on these pads, and it's mostly gas under Broomfield, are being shipped to other countries. This has nothing to do with the United States. We have a surplus and we are shipping it to other countries. We are energy independent on oil and gas. Could you advance, please? These are the countries that over the last few years we've sold our oil and gas to. Some of them countries that we're politically friendly with, the United Kingdom, for instance. Some of them, maybe not so much. We have a surplus of oil and gas. We have enough to meet all our needs, and we're shipping it to other countries. Drilling in Broomfield has nothing to do with energy independence. And yes, I use natural gas. Our hot water heater, for instance, runs on natural gas. It doesn't mean that I want it next to my home. I shop at Sprouts and King Supers. I don't want those right next to my home. I fill up my car with gas at the gas station. I don't want a gas station right next to my home. I painted a lot of our house, the interior of our house. I don't want a paint factory next to my home. These are ridiculous, ridiculous arguments that are not based in logic. And rights, people talk about rights. The oil and gas company, they have rights. Yeah, they have rights. Rights that were given to them by politicians who they paid for. Sorry. And sometimes rights given to them by people that really believe in the industry and are cheerleaders for the industry. We also have rights, and we should have more rights. We are the people that live here. This is our community, not their community. So yes, the gas and oil industry has rights, and I don't think that that trumps our rights. But that is one of the arguments for this project, are the rights that they have. So now I'd like to cover some of the cons. There's too many to list here. I'm going to kind of hit some bullet points. These are examples. This is not an exhaustive list. Health and safety. Let's just start there because that's the biggest one. Dr. Lisa McKenzie from right here in Colorado School of Colorado Public Health did a quite extensive study, peer-reviewed. Peer-reviewed means there's other scientists that have an understanding of this area that pick apart her data. They try to punch holes in it. They try to find things wrong with it. They make sure that it's a robust study. That's what a peer-reviewed study is. This is a peer-reviewed study, and it found that childhood leukemia, four times more likely in people living in the highest density of oil and gas wells. Okay? Four times more likely, childhood leukemia. Low birth weights. This is a recent one. Researchers from Princeton, University of Chicago, UCLA, worked together on a study, the most comprehensive that I think anybody I've ever talked to is aware of. 1.1 million births they studied. And they concluded that babies born to mothers living near fracking sites more likely to give birth to babies that weigh under 5.5 pounds at birth. And that number is significant because when you weigh less than that at birth, you are at an extraordinarily higher risk for other types of health problems. So baby born within a kilometer, just over half a mile of fracking sites, 25% more likely to be born with a low birth rate, or below 5.5 pounds. This medical compendium out of New York State. This one is from March of 18, previous editions. These scientists, these doctors actually, doctors have expressed their concerns and gone into great detail explaining the problems of residential drilling. They've concluded that there is no safe way to do this. That's why there are several states that have completely banned this. States where it was a huge booming industry, by the way, not just states that didn't have it at all to begin with. There's problems in communities with drilling. Erie was mentioned. There's tons of drilling in Erie. And as you saw in Heidi's pictures with the nosebleeds, there's nosebleeds, migraines, respiratory problems, itching eyes. There was a point where all at once there was, when I got the last count, well over 100 people that had contacted COGCC about these problems. Now I know they put it on social media and they say, here's a link, if you're having problems, you can contact them. But I would say, I don't know what the last count was, 125, let's say, people contacted COGCC with complaints on behalf of their family. 125 contacted the COGCC emergency health hotline. How many people really know about that hotline? If 100, 125 contacted them, how many didn't? And this was all at once. There was some kind of belch of toxins from the earth that happened during these drilling or completion operations. This went on for weeks with some of these people. Weeks. I would say that if something makes your nose bleed multiple times, regularly, over and over and over for days or weeks, that's just a symptom. That's not really the problem. Who knows what you have inhaled and what the real problem is? That's what I would be worried about, honestly. Colorado Department of Public Health came out to monitor, do some air studies. They said everything is in the acceptable range here. If everything was in the acceptable range, that either means that the normal acceptable range of toxins can cause these problems, or it means that by the time they get out there a couple days later, after the first big surge of calls, they didn't find it. The air had moved it, you know, whatever. Their equipment isn't good enough, I have no idea. But for some reason, they said everything was fine and acceptable. A couple more cons. This is Extraction's comprehensive drilling plan. Extraction has outlined in incredible detail how they're going to do these six pads. Everything from the landscaping all the way up to where the pipelines will be located, where the pads will be located, and everything else. Part of that is a risk assessment. This is Extraction's risk assessment and Extraction's comprehensive drilling plan. Okay, if you could advance. First of all, these are a descriptor for the individual risks. They have a huge table of risks, and each risk gets one of these. I'm not going to focus on all of it, it's too much. It's on the city and county's website, Broomfield's website, if you want to look at it. It's a document that I believe is 1,464 pages. But you can cruise to the risk assessment section or any other section you want. I'm going to focus here just on the catastrophic risks. 23 of them listed. Catastrophic, as it sounds, fatality, serious injury, devastating impact to the environment or community. Then each risk also gets a level of severity. I mean, sorry, this severity was catastrophic. This is a level of likelihood of it happening. So the lowest likelihood is rare, less than 2% chance. This is Extraction's document. Unlikely is between 3 and 10%, so they call that unlikely. So there's 12 that are catastrophic and unlikely, 3 to 10%, and there's two more that are potentially catastrophic and rare. So I know that this is a bit small, but things like vapor cloud explosion, fire explosion, well blowout, lightning, leading to an explosion, aquifer or well water contamination, surface water pollution, chemical exposure, corrosion leading to material loss, mechanical failure leading to material loss. These are things that would have catastrophic impacts. Human error, miscommunication, faulty design or construction, flood, storage tank collapse, IT system failures. Okay? These last two are rare, the less than 2%. The other 12, 3 to 10% each. Each. This is extractions document that they've submitted to the city. Some people would think they've underestimated risk. Some people think that they would hit it right on the nose. Some think they might overestimate it. Oh, maybe they would give us too high of a risk rating for some reason. But these are some of the things that we're looking at. So if you could advance it again, a hazard analysis expert from Anthem Ranch just did a very basic formula for those risks. And just the ones labeled as catastrophic have a 57% chance likelihood of happening during the well's lifetime. Okay, 57% chance just of the catastrophic. You could advance those. Let's go on to another one. Windsor, Colorado, not too far east of here. The explosion, fire spill combination that happened there. This is what it looked like. Those walls, for reference, I believe are 32 feet high, the walls behind that fire, 32 feet high. They didn't identify a true root cause. Okay, so we're not sure a couple things that could have happened. We're gonna put in place better management to oversee this. We're gonna move the walls back a little bit so maybe vapors don't collect as much, a couple other things, but they are not certain what happened. That's according to them. Or they haven't released it. But as far as we've been told in Broomfield, they're not certain what happened. People don't want risk forced on them. One of the differences between residential drilling and rural drilling is often in a rural area, somebody says, please come onto my land. I want to make money from this operation, and I'm not worried about health consequences. Also, when there's explosions, fires, blowouts, you might evacuate people for 15 miles around. It might be a couple homes. It's different when risk is forced on people instead of us choosing it. If I choose to drive on a slippery highway in the dark, I'm taking a risk that I have chosen. If I tell you, you have to go on I-25 and drive tonight on a super slippery night, snow and ice on the road, it's dark, and you say, no, too dangerous out there. And I say, no, you have to, because if you don't, I won't make money. That's different. We don't want generally risk forced on us. Community impact, truck traffic, noise, housing values. Just on the Livingston pad, one of the six, during the completion stage where you get the most trucks, you know, these are big heavy duty trucks. These aren't like pickup trucks, these are commercial trucks. About 183 per day. In that one phase, for that one pad, and that one phase will last about 10 to 12 months. I didn't put up here water, I was remiss. This project would take anywhere from, say, 40 to 80 million gallons of water out of our water system. Water that won't be treated and put back in the system, like most of our water is, water that will be removed from the system. Forced pooling, taking of somebody's property. You own mineral rights, they can come in and take it. When they're paying you money, they keep the first number of dollars until 200% of their risk has been paid for. 200% of their expected risk has been paid for. You pay for that with forced pooling. I want to give a quick analogy on this. Super Bowl 32 and 33. You know who won those games? Denver Broncos. Come on, people. I'm from Chicago and I know that. John Elway, actually, the quarterback, ran for touchdowns in both those games. So what if one of you owns a signed football, the one he ran into the end zone signed by him? And what if your neighbor owns a signed football from the next game, the next Super Bowl they won, one he ran into the end zone and was signed by him? And you're thinking, this is one of my valued possessions. I love this football. And your neighbor's like, yeah, I like this football, but I'll sell it to someone for enough money. And someone says, I'll buy your football, but only if I can buy your neighbor's also, because it's the pair that's really valuable to me. And you say, yeah, let's go talk to the neighbor. And you go over to the neighbor's like, no way am I selling you my John Elway touchdown football from the Super Bowl. Ain't happening. No way. And then they say, well, this person can't sell me their football because it's not worth it to me to buy only that one unless I get them both. And say, sorry, but this is mine and it's not for sale. And then they go to the state and they say, we want you to create laws, rules that let me, a private corporation that's operating for a profit, to just take this person's football, and then I will also determine how much I will pay them for it. And before I give them their money, first I'm taking 200% of the money I need to offset my risk. As far as polling, that's a bunch of crap. Those are property rights that you hear about in Russia. Yeah. This is not the United States of America. Where can we go from here? Legal options. There's some limitations. There's also some debate about how far to push things, how much risk to incur if we want to take a legal stance against extraction. These are heavily debated issues. There certainly is not a consensus on what to do. Compliance with the contract falls under there, though. They're not in total compliance now already. And I know a number of us believe that they need to be held in strict compliance because even though it's not good enough for me to feel safe, I don't want to dip below that contract. What can you do? Contact council representatives. City and council webpage has one email address that you can email everybody on council at the same time. It also goes to a few senior staff members and a couple other people, but it will get to all of us at the same time. You could look up who your specific council members are and email them. And whether you're here for this project, you want this, or you're here against it, make your voice known. Please go back. Thank you. Contact your state senator or representative. Our state senator is Vicki Marple. Our state representative is Matt Gray. Some people laugh at Vicki Marple. If you don't know why they're laughing, it's because Vicki Marple has voted against except for one minor bill that I'm going to talk about in a minute. She's voted against every significant piece of gas and oil legislation possible. She also represents Firestone, where that explosion happened. And when there was a bill to just map pipelines, not even restrict drilling, just map the pipelines, she spoke against it and tried to shut the whole thing down. She represented Firestone. Lori Sane is their representative. She did the same thing. Our representative at the state capitol is Matt Gray. And you can vote. And I won't tell you who to vote for, but I can ask you to please look into who does what or feels what way on oil and gas. Now, a lot of us don't vote on single issues, so I'm not telling you you have to vote on this issue alone. But if you're here on a Friday night, it's important enough to you to probably at least be aware of where people stand. And when I say elected officials, yeah, gubernatorial, for sure. State House, State Senate, for sure. And City Council. City Council, for sure. Local politics impact your life more directly, more frequently, than even national politics. Worth it to see who's running in council races and who you want to get behind. Please advance. I want to close with a couple of acknowledgments. Matt Gray, our state representative. Matt helped usher a bill through in this last legislative session that helped make forced cooling not as bad. I'm not going to say that it went as far as he wanted or I want, but he helped make some amendments to the bill that made it palatable enough to at least get through. And for that, I want to give him some kudos. Next, please. Mike Foyt. You heard from Representative Mike Foyt. Mike has been nothing less than a champion and a workhorse on this cause. Mike has put himself on the line over and over and over for this. And I'm going to tell you from my city council experience how unbelievably painful that is. Because there are people out there to crush you. They will spend money hiring people to crush you when you speak out against this industry. He has not done just what's politically tenable or just enough to be popular. He has gone all the way in pushing these issues. And I can't tell you how much I appreciate somebody that will do what they believe is right in elective office. So many residents, way, way too many to thank. I started to put names up here and I was afraid I was going to miss people because we're interacting with hundreds. So many of them here, so many of them not here. Just an absolute, I'm tempted to start throwing out names, but then I'm going to miss one or two critical names and make them feel bad that they weren't right there on the tip of my tongue. So many residents have poured hours and hours into this. 10, 20, 40 hours a week for some of these residents. Many city staff and council members have put an inordinate amount of time into this issue. This has been a dominating issue for a year and a half. Just absolutely dominating. Is that an overestimate? No. Just dominating issue, city staff and city council. And then last, Bloomfield concerned. There are many, many groups out here. Bloomfield concerned, co-chairs Jennifer Dulles and Jean Lynn put together this event. This is not easy. This is not an easy event to organize. Again, this is all volunteer. And I just truly appreciate them giving you an opportunity to hear and for some of us an opportunity to talk. And I think that is it. My name is Kevin Krieger. I'll be here after if anybody has any questions or comments. Thank you so much for being so engaged in your community.
Kevin, thank you so much. Are we very, very fortunate to have you representing us? And that is the true voice of representation right there. Thank you, Kevin. Our next speaker, have you ever spent your Friday night with a lawyer? I am honored to introduce Dan Leftwich. Dan has quite the intimidating schedule, I'll say. I think he was filing something with the Supreme Court potentially today. We are fortunate to have him here in our community and spending time with us tonight. A little bit about him. Dan Leftwich has decades of experience in complex litigation, class actions, high-profile mediations, jury trials, and appeals in state and federal courts around the country. He has an undergraduate degree in journalism and a law degree from the University of Texas. During his 20-year span as a class action litigator with his former law firm based in Washington, D.C., Dan was involved in some of the most complex cases in the nation, addressing corporate monopoly power and unfair competition. He has lived in Boulder since 2003, He is the founder of MindDrive Legal Services, a public interest law firm focused on constitutional law, civil rights litigation, legal consulting, and community rights initiatives. Dan has been a tireless advocate on behalf of environmental issues and is the president of Resilient Communities Network, which is a Colorado nonprofit that promotes community resilience and democracy to end the fossil fuel era. He is co-counsel, one of the reasons he's here with us this evening, with the lawyers from Our Children's Trust on the very landmark Martinez case, where six teenagers filed a petition for rulemaking to stop oil and gas permitting until the state demonstrates its regulations protect the public health, safety, and the environment. The Colorado Court of Appeals agreed with the youth plaintiffs in ruling that public health, safety, and the environment must be protected before oil and gas development is allowed. And the state Supreme Court has agreed to hear an appeal from the state. Dan was also a very strong advocate for the passage of ballot measure 301 here in Broomfield. Mr. Dan Leftwich.
Good evening, everyone. Again, my name is Dan Leftwich, and I want to thank all the people who showed up, given your time here tonight, as well as all the people who have just devoted thousands of hours to helping their community understand these issues, deal with these issues in real time, and plan for the future, a better future for your families. Now, my talk tonight is going to be about the precautionary principle and the Martinez case, which Jennifer just mentioned in the introduction. And I'm going to go into some legal issues. I'll try not to be too technical. I'll try not to be too lawyer-like. But these are important issues for you to start to understand if you don't already, because they impact your lives in huge, huge ways. Councilman Krieger laid out a list of problems that the city council has had to deal with in trying to come to some agreement with extraction and other oil and gas companies that will protect the public health and safety. And you heard a lot about those obstacles. And I'm going to talk about those and give you some idea of how you can assert your own rights in the process. Okay. So the precautionary principle, what is that? When an activity raises threats of serious harm to human health, the environment, or wildlife, preventive measures should be taken, even if some cause and effect relationships are not fully established. Now this is very important, because what's going on in Colorado is that the battle is over whether people should have the burden of demonstrating that oil and gas activity, oil and gas development, conclusively causes them harm and causes harm to public health and safety and the environment conclusively, or whether the oil and gas companies should have the burden of proof to show that it doesn't harm public health and safety and the environment. Okay? That's an important distinction to make. Next slide. So to protect is to prevent harm, right? Not wait until the harm has occurred and then bring a lawsuit and try and show that your injuries were caused conclusively by this activity. Now, the term protect, there's a case in the town of Carbondale where the Court of Appeals heard arguments that the town of Carbondale wanted to pass a law to protect their water supply from development upstream. And of course, the developer pushed back and said, no, you can't do that. You have to wait until harm occurs and then show that our activity caused that harm. Well, the court said no. The term protect contemplates preventative measures undertaken before measurable pollution enters the municipality's water supply. Thus, a municipality is not limited to enacting ordinances that address only pollution or contamination that's already occurred. Okay? Now, this is the basic function of government, the police power, to protect the public health and safety and the environment. Not wait until you have children going to school with nosebleeds. Not waiting until the air quality is at an F grade. In Colorado, an environmentally friendly state. Next slide. Does anyone here, after listening to what you heard tonight, does anyone here think fracking is safe for neighborhoods? And it's okay if you do, please have the courage to hold your hand. No? Next slide. Well, if it's not safe, and according to expert analysis of 1,200 peer-reviewed studies, there's no evidence that fracking can be practiced in a manner that does not threaten human health and safety. So if it's not safe, why do we allow it to ruin our communities? Why do we allow it to handcuff our city councils? Why do we allow it to force people to sell or give their mineral rights to an oil and gas company so that it can then destroy their environment and destroy their health? These are the four pillars of coercion, and I want you to just take a moment, and if you want to take a screenshot of that, you're welcome to. I call this the fracking racket. I also call it the fracking Ponzi, but that's another matter. There are four areas that I've identified that are the major areas of coercion, that the oil and gas industry can coerce you, can coerce your city council, can coerce your county government into allowing their operations, these mega pads, 56 wells on a pad site is what they're doing now, into your neighborhoods, 500 feet from homes, or less if it's an existing well that new development came into and they refracked the well, they reopened the well. That's what happened at Firestone, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. So what are these areas of coercion? One, and I'm gonna go into this, you know, each of these in some detail, but not too much. State preemption of local laws. Now, what's preemption? You've probably heard of something about it because it's basically dominated the news around fracking. That's the power of the state to tell local governments and local communities that they can't pass local laws that are in conflict with state laws. If they do, those local laws are invalidated. That's what happened with the ballot initiatives in Longmont, Fort Collins, your ballot initiative in 2013 in Broomfield, which I helped our Broomfield in a ballot title contest, and I helped them understand the right of initiative. Okay. All of those were invalidated by the Supreme Court, as well as in Lafayette, and as well as in Loveland, others that have tried in Fort Collins. Because the court said state law is superior to local law when those two laws conflict, right? Now I'm gonna tell you why that's not the case. Forced access to open space. Now you may not know this, but in Colorado, the courts have said the mineral estate under the ground is the dominant estate. And in order for mineral rights owners to have the ability to extract their minerals, they have what's called an implied easement to access the surface estate in order to drill down and get at those minerals. There's some very important limitations to that, and I'm going to tell you about those a little bit here. But because of all the work that activists and community groups and neighborhoods and just ordinary people have done to push oil and gas away from their neighborhoods and to raise holy hell about this coercion, oil and gas companies now have found it necessary to find larger plots of land that they can then consolidate. Councilman Krieger mentioned that they kept telling him, we're going to consolidate, right? That's because they have to. The economics of fracking are such that they have to consolidate these operations on larger and larger multi-well pad sites. Okay? And in part, that's also because they've been getting so much pushback from neighborhoods. Right? So what they've done now, and they're doing this in Boulder County, they're doing this in Longmont, they're doing this in Lafayette, they're doing this in Thornton, they're doing this in Adams County. They're going for the open space. Public open space. Now, why is that? Because they can demand a surface use agreement from the city or the county that says, you have to let us onto this open space to put our operations so that we can get at the minerals underneath, right? Now, that's the basics, and I'm gonna go into a little bit more detail about that soon. The third form of coercion is forced pooling of mineral rights, and Councilman Krieger gave you a pretty vivid example of that, right? And this is where some of you may have already received a letter from an oil and gas company saying, we want to lease your mineral rights, and they want you to enter into sign an agreement with them, right? Well, what they don't tell you is, and sometimes now they're just coming out and telling you, right? That if you don't sign this agreement, will force boom you. Because in Colorado, there is no standard for what percentage of mineral rights owners have to agree. For example, it doesn't take a majority of mineral rights owners to agree in order to force pool the rest. Okay? Technically, one mineral rights owner can lease their mineral rights to the company, and then the company can go to the COGCC and get a forced pooling order for the 99%. Right? Now, I'm going to tell you why that's, in my view, this is my opinion, why that's unconstitutional. And fourth is the threat of takings claims. This is where, in the Constitution, there's a due process provision that says government can't take private property for public use without fair compensation. All right? So the oil and gas companies have held this over the heads of city councils and county governments, saying, well, if you regulate this, or if you ban this in the long run, or if you place a moratorium on this, in Broomfield and Fort Collins, that takes our mineral rights and you have to pay us for them. And that's going to cost you millions and millions of dollars. Okay? So that's been a big club that they've used. I'm going to tell you why that's not correct. Now, underlying all of this is cheap money. Right? It has been cheap money from the Fed, okay, but cheap money from the stock market, and extraction is a case study in it. Okay? First, they had private sources of funds for their operations, blew through that. Then they did an IPO, went on public on the stock market, had a huge splash in the stock market. 6-9 months later, they were in the bond market looking for more money. 9 months later, they were back in the bond market looking for more money. This time to invest, get bond investors to invest so that they could pay off the other bond investors, okay? Because those bonds will be coming due, right? So this is the churn that tells you they're not making money, they're losing money, all right? Fracking has never been economical. Even at $100 a barrel in oil. So if they're not making money at $100 a barrel in oil, do you think they're making money at $40 a barrel? Okay? They'll tell you they are, and they'll use their own definitions of profit, their own definitions of costs, and all kinds of things. But that doesn't make it true. Okay? Fracking cannot survive without coercion. Now, I dare you to find any other business model in the United States that can coerce people to allow it in their neighborhoods, to threaten their public health and safety, and to threaten their children's lives. I dare you to find one. Okay, next slide. So the first pillar of coercion, state preemption of local laws under Dillon's rule. Now, I'm not always gonna have these dense slides, okay? But this is important. Because preemption, now there's a difference between federal preemption, which is based in the supremacy clause of the Constitution. Federal law is the supreme law of the land, therefore state laws or local laws in conflict therewith are superseded. Okay? But there is no such provision in the state constitution. Right? And the Colorado Supreme Court has said that the Oil and Gas Conservation Act, which is the statute that gives the COGCC its powers, does not expressly or impliedly preempt local law, okay? So let's get that out of the way. So there's only one form of preemption that applies in Colorado, and that's called operational conflict preemption. It means if local laws are passed that are in conflict with state laws and would impede or destroy the state's interest, those laws are preempted, okay? Now, all of that is based on an 1868 court case in Iowa. Okay? It's called Dillon's Rule. Judge John Dillon, former corporate lawyer, he said, because the state creates the municipal corporation, which is a city, okay, creates it, gives it its powers, breathes life into it, it can take those powers away. It can abridge them. It can limit them. It can destroy the city itself. It can collapse the city. So I'll give you an example. Detroit, you've heard, you know, over the last decade or so, Detroit's been in bankruptcy. It's been, you know, just completely failed city, right? Well, the state came in and basically said, we don't care whether you voted for a city manager and for your own elected politicians. We're going to take over the city. We're just going to basically run it, all right? That's preemption. Now, if it may destroy, it may abridge and control, right? Dillon's rule is the sole basis for state preemption in Colorado. Now, next slide. Here's what the city and the state don't tell you, right? When they say, we can't do this, we can't regulate further than we want to because of preemption. Our hands are tied. How many times have you heard that? Okay? Our hands are tied. We don't have as many tools in our toolbox. What they don't tell you is that the authority of the legislature when restricting or withdrawing a municipality's powers, preemption, is subject to the fundamental condition that the collective and individual rights of the people of the municipality shall not be destroyed. So understand that. The rights of the people of the city of Broomfield are not synonymous with the powers of the municipal government of Broomfield, okay? Now I'll give you an example of why this is so important. In the city of Longmont in 2012, Councilman Krueger laid out Representative Foote laid out the history of the city of Longmont tried to regulate oil and gas. They got sued by the state for preemption. Well, the people said, okay, you're not going far enough. We're going to pass an initiative. We're going to pass a ban on fracking in the city. They did that, 60 to 40, okay? And against huge odds, huge money difference, okay? So COGA, the Colorado Oil and Gas Association, sued the city government for preemption, using the state's power of preemption, saying, well, we have a right to use the state's power of preemption to stop this ban from limiting our activities, okay? And the court, in the district court, and then they bypassed, you know, found in favor of COGA, found that preemption applied. They bypassed the Court of Appeals, went straight to the Colorado Supreme Court, and the Colorado Supreme Court said, yes, there's operational conflict between a ban on fracking or a moratorium on fracking that lasts longer than a very short duration, as in Fort Collins. And that conflict would destroy or impede the state's interest in efficient development of oil and gas, therefore it's preempted. Now, not once, there isn't one sentence, there isn't one thought about the fact that these were constitutional initiatives. These were not city council regulations. These were not regulations passed by the city council. In fact, the citizens had to pass initiatives over the heads of the city council. Now that's important because those constitutional rights are superior to the powers of the city government. Dillon's rule cannot be used to preempt your rights to the protections of Amendment 301. Next slide. The right of initiative, which is Article 5, Section 1, 9, that's the local right of initiative. You have the power to pass laws, all special municipal legislation of every character in or for your municipality. Right? And even though the matter may be of statewide concern, the General Assembly has no power to enact any law that denies a right specifically found in the Constitution. So this is why COGA sued the city government of Fort Collins and the city government of Longmont. And then they fought to keep citizens groups out of the litigation because that way they can't raise their rights, okay? And so the right of initiative was never discussed at any level of those cases, all right? Now, next slide. And before I leave preemption, it's important that you understand this because you have more power than your city council does. All right? Now, the second pillar of coercion is forced action to your open space. There's an implied easement to use the surface estate in order to get at the mineral rights, right? But beneath the surface, not for miles in every direction, okay? Because these doctrines, the dominant mineral estate is what it's called, those come from an old era of vertical wells where you had to have access to the surface estate in order to get access to the minerals underneath that surface estate. But that's not what's going on. Now they're using the surface estate for 56 wells to frack in 3 miles in every direction, under every neighborhood in a circumference of miles. Right? Now, the Supreme Court of Colorado has said, if you exceed the scope of your implied easement, that's a trespass. Right? If you exceed the scope by destroying, there's no implied easement to destroy the surface estate, including to destroy the value of the surface estate. And there's no implied easement to use the surface estate to frack in every direction. Okay? Just isn't. Now, public open space is a separate sort of category, right? Because it's a public trust. And in Boulder County, since 1993, we've spent $100 million taxing ourselves, giving $100 million to the county commissioners in order to buy open space and to protect it, right? To conserve it, to keep it from development, right? Now that open space right now is under threat from Crestone and Extraction. They both have comprehensive drilling plans before the COGCC to put 114, 128 wells on our open space. One property, we spent $8 million to acquire it in 2016. That's the Wheeler property, right? They're proposing to put 56 wells on that property. Now, I tell you this because I know that there's some open space involved in the negotiations between the city council and Extraction, and beware, okay? City council, whoever the government officials are that have been given the money to acquire open space and are given a list of duties in order to protect that open space, they are trustees. They have a fiduciary duty to preserve that open space for the beneficiaries, which are the citizens, okay? So when they start talking about swapping, making swaps and giving away mineral rights and giving away open space in order to donate it so that they can get another piece of land, right? Be very aware of what's going on, right? Next. The third pillar of coercion is forced pooling. And we talked a little bit about that. It's basically, look at it this way, all right? It's eminent domain for private corporations, right? It's not eminent domain so that the government can take property for public use, right, and pay you for it. It's eminent domain for private corporations for private profit, right? And they not only don't pay you for it, they'll just take it. And they'll penalize you 200% of their costs before they ever pay you, okay, because you're a holdout, because you had to be forced pooled, right? And I can tell you also that the COGCC never denies a forced pooling order, right? So anytime you hear something where government never exercises its discretion to deny a permit, right? That's an abuse of discretion, right? Now, it's also a taking of private property for private use. There's a provision in the Colorado Constitution that prohibits this, right? It's a due process violation as well. There's no standard in the forced pooling statutes that says, well, you have to have a majority. If you have a majority of people who voluntarily sign their mineral rights, then you can force pool the minority, right, to avoid holdouts. No, doesn't matter. In some cases, there's been a bare minority. that has force-pooled the majority. Okay? Now, that's a due process violation. And it's a First Amendment violation. And this, again, this is just my opinion, right? They're forcing you to become a joint venturer with Extraction Oil and Gas, or Crestone. I don't want to just pick out Extraction because it's Anadarko, it's every oil and gas company, right? They take advantage of these forced pooling rules, and they have to have it, right? Now, this comes from a legacy period of the old days of oil and gas drilling, where in the 1920s, where the rule of capture applied, which says, if I drill a well down on my property and into these big, huge pools of oil, and gravity allows oil from your property to go into my well bore, it's the rule of capture. I got it, it's mine, okay? And the court said, if you don't want that to happen, you have a remedy. You can drill your own well, okay? And so what happened is, there are pictures of neighborhoods where there's a well on every property, in every backyard, right? So to avoid that, they said, okay, we're gonna allow these tracts of oil to be pooled, right? And so it's more efficient, and so that we don't have an oil well on every single piece of property, right? We have one oil well, and then the people in the pool say, okay, you drain the oil from that well, and you pay me for my share, right? But that's not what's going on anymore, right? Fracking doesn't rely on gravity, huge pools of oil, in order to basically take oil from someone else's property. No, they have to go get it. They have to drill underground for miles. They have to set up explosions, all right? Then they have to pump chemicals that are, you know, massive cancer-causing chemicals and huge amounts of water and sand into the rock in order to force it open so that that shale allows the oil and gas to come out and flow back up into the well bore, right? That's not the rule of capture, and it doesn't apply anymore. And there's a case in Pennsylvania very recently in the last 2 months that has held that the rule of capture really doesn't apply in the fracking context. Now, it's not the only case on the issue, but people are starting to wake up to the fact that you don't just assume that these old laws can't apply to your situation. Now, I say that these are First Amendment rights because we have freedom of association in this country. It's part of the First Amendment, right? I have the freedom to associate with people that I want or not to associate with people that I don't agree with, right? I have the freedom not to give money, not to give property to people who are going to put forward massive numbers of propaganda messages that I don't agree with, and that are they're going to use that money and my property in order to threaten my health and safety. Okay? I have the freedom not to do that. And that's a fundamental right. It's important that you understand fundamental rights are a separate category of rights. They're not just ordinary rights. Fundamental rights are so important that we've done away with the balancing of state and local interests. That is the basis for most preemption decisions. Fundamental rights, no. We've decided those are so important, the state has to show a compelling governmental interest that can't be done any other way, all right? It's called strict scrutiny. And the courts have said, it's strict in theory, fatal in fact, okay? The state very rarely can show a compelling governmental interest in taking your property, right, and coercing you to put massive industrial operations in your neighborhood. Now, these things need to be challenged, all right? And so I am working with others in order to raise the legal challenges, to challenge every one of these pillars of coercion. Okay. Next. And the fourth pillar is the threat of takings claims, and I already told you about, they use this as the hammer, right? But in fact, all property rights come with responsibilities. When you buy property, it doesn't come with the right to create a nuisance. It doesn't come with the right to threaten public health and safety, okay? And local governments and the citizens in those local governments through the initiative process have the right to pass laws to protect the public health and safety, even if it means it's going to deprive you of your property, right? Because that's the way government has to function. We can't allow property owners to basically destroy the public health and safety just because they bought property, you know, somewhere and we didn't even have any chance to stop it, right? That's what the police power is. It's the basic fundamental power of government, right? So the precautionary principle applied to fracking. The time to ensure the impacts on public health are properly considered is before a state permits drilling, right? Now this is a responsible commissioner of public health in New York. And this was the decision that led to the fracking ban in New York, okay? Because the compendium of health studies in New York convinced this public health officer that I need to decide, is this safe before permits are issued? That's not what happens in Colorado. Dr. Larry Walk, the head of the Colorado Department of Public Health and the Environment, in our case, in the Martinez case, he issued an opinion that said, well, you presented all these studies, and I've looked at them, but they don't conclusively show that oil and gas activity is harming public health and safety. Therefore, the COGCC should just go ahead and continue permitting. That's your Department of Public Health, right? Next slide. So what is the public interest in that is in the Oil and Gas Conservation Act? It's in the public interest to foster the responsible, balanced development, production and utilization of the natural resources of oil and gas in the state of Colorado in a manner consistent with the protection of public health, safety, and welfare, including protection of the environment and wildlife resources. Now, the second part is not met, the first part is not met, okay? First part can't be allowed. Now, in the Martinez case, I represent six teenagers who are concerned about their future, all right? They're concerned about climate change. They're concerned about whether they will have a future. And so they filed a petition with the COGCC saying, we want you to issue a rulemaking that demonstrates that your permitting processes protect public health and safety before you can allow them to go forward. Of course, the agency denied the petition. We took an appeal to the district court. District court sided with the agency, said, no, the agency seizes on that word balanced development, right? And says, well, we have to balance oil and gas operators' interests, their economic interests, their technical feasibility, against the public health and safety in the environment, right? And so that balance, that approach, is what the district court said, yeah, I think in the statute, that's the way I read the statute. We took an appeal to the Court of Appeals. The Court of Appeals said this. Court of Appeals, go to the next slide. I'll go back, I'm sorry. So the Court of Appeals looked at the entire statute, including that need to foster responsible and balanced oil and gas development. By the way, in the public hearing over the petition for rulemaking, one of the commissioners said, well, you know this responsible and balanced term? Everyone on this commission has a different definition of what that is. And me, I like the responsible part, you know, because it means I get to say what's responsible drilling, but every one of us has a different definition. Well, that is the definition of arbitrary action, all right? Now, this is the COGC's mandate in the Oil and Gas Conservation Act. The commission shall, as of 2007 amendments to the statute, shall promulgate rules in consultation with the Department of Public Health and the Environment to protect the health, safety, and welfare of the general public in the conduct of oil and gas. That's it. What's unclear about that, right? Not unless the oil and gas operators say it's going to cost them money. Not unless, well, they need you to issue a waiver because they don't think that they can that they can deal with this without, you know, giving some leeway. No. Their mandate is to pass rules that protect the public health and safety in the conduct of oil and gas operations. Next slide. So the opposite of precaution is what the COGCC did. They issue rules first, such as the setback rules. Say, these setback rules are not intended to address potential human health impacts associated with air emissions related to oil and gas development. Well, I'm sorry. If they're not intended to address human health impacts from air pollution, then what are you doing issuing any setback rules? You don't have a basis for understanding what a rational setback is. And in fact, all they did was they did a balancing of oil and gas interests, farmers, activists. Activists wanted, you know, 1,500, 2,000 feet. Oil and gas interests, they just wanted 300 feet. And, you know, and then they said, they just picked a number. They picked a number in the middle. They said 500 feet for homes, 1,000 feet for, you know, high occupancy buildings. But, you know, schools, we're not going to bother saying it has to be 1,000 feet from the playground. Just say 1,000 feet from the building. Right? So that's how arbitrary it was. Now, so they issue rules first, and then they study the health effects later. They say, because you can't show that oil and gas development is going to conclusively cause public health and safety to be destroyed, we're going to go ahead and issue these rules, and then we'll study the health effects. Right? Next slide. So the COGCC, at one point, agreed. They said, yes, we agree, in Colorado, this means the development of these natural resources must be consistent with protection of public health, safety, and welfare, including the environment, at all times. And then, when the district court sided with them, they scrubbed it from their website. Right? But we caught them, we got a screenshot, and the Court of Appeals actually cited this in part of their opinion. So the Martinez opinion is a published decision. It's binding on all lower courts in this state. There's been a bunch of talk, and I've received emails from council people and government officials saying, no, it's not binding because it's on appeal to the Supreme Court. No, it's binding precedent, okay? But the COGCC, they're not following it. Next slide. This is the law. The clear language of the Act, supported by the Act's legislative evolution and the Commission's own enforcement criteria, mandates the development of oil and gas be regulated subject to the protection of public health, safety, and the environment. Right? Subject to. So you need to be demanding enforcement of the Martinez opinion. Right? Next slide. This is what balancing oil companies' interests against the public health and safety looks like. This is what it does, all right? Next slide. That's Firestone. 2 weeks after Firestone, the COGCC approved 500 new permits. Next slide. This is what preemption looks like. This is Weld County. This is coming to Broomfield, okay? I guarantee you, if you don't stand up for your rights, this is coming to you. Next slide. This is what preemption does to families. I know I'm going to run over time a little bit, but this is important. Recently, an Erie mother went public, and she's a scientist, right? She went public with the fact that her child, her six-year-old boy, she tested it for VOC levels because she wanted to get a baseline. She lives in Erie in the middle of 158 oil and gas wells within a mile. And her son's VOC levels, benzene, ethylbenzene, and other cancer-causing chemicals were in the 85th, 90th percentile. Right? Now, what was the COGCC's response? They said, well, when was your son last at a gas station? I'm not kidding. Another mother in Erie had her four-year-old son tested. Same thing, benzene. Levels, 90th percentile, okay? And he's been having horrible health impacts. Has to sleep in the bathroom, she told me, okay? Now, what was the Department of Public Health Health's response to her raising complaints, they interrogated her for about an hour and a half on the phone, asked her to produce her son's medical records, asked her where she got the blood drawn, who transported the blood. Okay? This is your Department of Public Health and the Environment. This isn't studies, this is real people. Next slide. This is what preemption does to communities. These are the complaints. It's just the last year. Okay? Oil spills, 617 in last year. Explosions, 14. Fines issued, $7.1 million. That didn't say fines collected. Permits denied or suspended? Zero. Zero. Excellent. Now the Berthoud, the spewing Berthoud abandoned well, right? In Berthoud, one Sunday morning, an abandoned well that hadn't been, nobody had even known it existed for decades, starts spewing black goo and carbon products. Within an hour or two, extraction oil and gas representatives were on site to help with the cleanup. How did they know? Okay. Well, they were drilling a well over 3,000 feet away and must have seen the pressure dropping in their well and said, we got a problem here. And so the COGCC investigated, I'm using air quotes here, and found that the abandoned well was improperly capped and improperly abandoned, okay? Because they didn't require so much paperwork back in the 80s, all right? So they cleaned it up, but then they found an odd thing. It's one of the oddities of this situation. There was a well less than 100 feet away that did not cause this to happen, but there's a well more than 3,000 feet away that may have caused this event. Right? Now, what does that tell you? I want you to think about that, because that means there's spacing rules where they say this is how far apart well bores have to be, and they grant variances all the time to the spacing rules. Right? They don't have a clue. It's arbitrary. Right? They can't tell. Why did this well cause it 3,000 feet away? Right? Next slide. Extraction's unexplained Windsor explosion. Councilman Krieger talked about that. That's what it looked like. Okay. Benzene spikes were picked up by NSTAR, a research group, at Boulder Reservoir. Okay. Now, what's that tell you? Right? That their setback rules are completely arbitrary. Right? Imagine this in your neighborhood. Anthem Ranch, you probably can't see this very well, but there's a whole lot of abandoned wells under your neighborhood, right? And they don't have a clue which one of their wells that they're going to be drilling, new wells, which one of those wells is going to be impacting an abandoned well. That's the Berthoud mystery, okay? So, next slide. Now, 301 is a local version of the Martinez standard. And I'm not going to go into detail about that because you all know about that. Next slide. But Martinez sets a floor, not a ceiling. Okay? This is important that you understand this. It says the Oil and Gas Commission must protect the public health and safety before issuing new permits. Okay? It doesn't say that local governments can't go above what the COGC says. But they use preemption to stop you from doing that. And I just told you, that's not correct. Next slide. 301 does not impede or destroy the state's interest in protecting the public health and safety in oil and gas drilling. So there's no conflict, right? No, preemption should not apply. And one of the unquestioned purposes of the referendum initiative powers is to permit the total and free exercise of legislative power by the people. That's what you did when you passed 301. Okay? Its power is a direct check on the exercise or non-exercise of legislative power by elected officials. So the COGCC isn't protecting you. You have full legislative power in or for your city to pass legislation to protect your own public health and safety. Excellent. If the state won't protect the public, local governments have the power to do it. That's the police power. Next slide. If local governments won't protect the public, the people have the right and the power to protect themselves. Next slide. So where do we go from here? What can you do? Demand enforcement of the Martinez standard and enforcement of 301. 301 sets a standard. It's not up to the citizens to have to tell the city council, with all due respect, right? It's not up to them to negotiate and bargain and say, okay, here's regulations that we'll agree to and we won't agree to. No, city council's responsibility to enforce 301. It sets a standard. They have to pass regulations that enforce it, okay? Support 2,500-foot setback initiative. That's Colorado Rising. Support legal efforts to challenge the pillars of coercion. Okay? And use CORA, the Open Records Act, Open Meetings Law, to stop secret votes. Right? Enough. And organize, resist, and adapt. Right? But never, ever compromise on protection of public health and safety. Never, under any circumstances, because without that, you've got nothing. Next slide. And seize the initiative. Take back your power. Understand your rights. Defend your rights. Okay? It's gonna be costly, but that's what you have to do. Next slide. And that's it. Thank you.
I want to thank Dan so much for taking the time to do that. I know there's some complex issues, but again, overarching highlights, right, and takeaways in terms of the message that we can send to our city council and the things that we can be doing. So with that, we've got one last speaker. We've got two folks who are going to share the stage this evening. Lori Anderson, who is a resident here in Broomfield, and Sarah Laughlin, who is the executive director of Logic. And as they come up to the stage, I'll tell you a little bit about them. Lori Anderson was instrumental in the passage of ballot measure 301 here in Broomfield, and Sarah Laughlin is the executive director of the League of Oil and Gas Impacted Citizens, otherwise known as Logic. Ballot initiative 301 was an effort of Logic's action committee, and we're thrilled to have both of them here tonight. Lori resides in the Anthem Highlands neighborhood. She's a mom to five school-age kids. She has been concerned about the planned fracking near her community in Broomfield since she first heard about it in 2016. Lori's one of the co-founders of the Broomfield Clean Air and Water, whose mission is to protect the citizens of Broomfield from adverse health, safety, and environmental impacts of oil and gas exploration and drilling within residential communities. She's been working closely with Logic, a member group, and has recently joined them as their community organizer to bring some of her efforts in Broomfield to the communities across the state. Sarah Laughlin is the founding executive director of the League of Oil and Gas Impacted Coloradans, which works to ensure that Coloradans living with oil and gas are heard when it comes to oil and gas decisions and policies. Logic launched in January of 2016 by a group of impacted citizens and community groups working to bring about an effective and coordinated voice of impacted Coloradans. Logic works to educate and engage the public around oil and gas issues, to change the conversation on oil and gas in Colorado, and to bring about public policies that prioritize public health, safety, and our natural resources. In the last 2 years alone, Logic has worked to ensure that citizen voices are heard at the local, the state, and the federal level. Lori and Sarah, if you'll come and join me on stage. Thank you. Okay, this will be short and sweet. It is powerful that people have the right to initiative. We have the power to create change at the state level as well as at the local level to help protect public health, safety, and welfare. The 2,500-foot setback initiative that Heidi presented earlier is an example of a statewide ballot initiative that is underway. As an example of a local initiative, last year, residents of Broomfield formed a new group, Broomfield Health and Safety First, and with the guidance from the League of Oil and Gas Pact of Coloradans, brought forth a local health and state initiative, Question 301. Last November, Broomfield residents voted on whether or not to add the exact language as shown on the ballot to Section 2.1 of the Broomfield Charter. This language requires Broomfield to condition oil and gas development permits such that they protect the public's health, safety, and welfare, and safeguard the environment and wildlife resources. Despite being outspent about 10 to 1 with heavy opposition from the industry, Broomfield successfully passed Question 301 with a 57% majority, just as in any other Democratic vote, the measure which passed must be upheld. The 301 committee is now working with the city to ensure that the language of Question 301 is upheld. The exact language has been added to Section 2.1 of the Broomfield City Charter. Broomfield is currently revising their oil and gas regulations, and the 301 committee is reviewing these regulations and making suggestions. Ultimately, it is the city's responsibility to ensure that the public health, safety, and welfare is protected. The city is also currently reviewing the fourth revision of a comprehensive drilling plan that was submitted by Extraction Oil and Gas, who proposes to drill 84 wells in northern Broomfield in close proximity to our residential communities, schools, the future drinking water reservoir, and more. The 301 committee has provided in-depth feedback with regard to concerns that the drilling plan does not meet the criteria protecting public health, safety, welfare, and the environment. The city must not administratively approve any drilling plan until the conditions of 301 are met. Considering that the current drilling plan includes a 3 to 10% chance of many different catastrophic events, which Councilmember Krieger had mentioned, which include vapor cloud explosions, well blowout, aquifer well water contamination, and the chemical cloud with sufficiently significant quantities to cause harm or injury drifting into residential communities, mechanical failures, and human error, among others, does not meet the conditions of 301. It is also essential that the city have enforcement mechanisms in place which ensure that if an operator were to receive permits to drill in Broomfield because their operations would not adversely impact the health, safety, welfare, and environment, the city must have the authority to enforce the regulations and the operator agreement, including the comprehensive drilling plan. We need your help, though. We need residents to continue to connect with their council members to let them know you are still concerned. Send a quick email, continue to support our sign-on letters, and come to council meetings when oil and gas is on the agenda. And for those who have the time and ability to really get involved, grab a cup of coffee or take a walk with your council member and let them know how important protecting the health, safety, and welfare of our community is, and share your ideas. Much of Greenfield's success is built on the principle that knowledge is power. Please share your knowledge with your friends and neighbors, and even write letters to the editor to share with the broader community. We are all in need of donations. We are also in need of donations to help keep the efforts of 301 committee moving forward. At our newest edition, we will be placing an order for 301 shirts. These shirts can be worn to events to show your support of 301. All proceeds will help the 301 committee continue their work. You can see it's all in the lobby. As much as these initiatives that are helpful to our mission, there are also initiatives that are not beneficial to protecting public health, safety, wealth, and the environment, as you are about to find out. So Sarah.
And thank you, Jennifer, and Broomfield Concern for hosting tonight. As Jennifer said, I'm Sarah Laughlin. I'm the executive director for the League of Oil and Gas Impacted Coloradans. We represent about 18 neighborhood groups around the state. And what I want to talk about is your 2018 ballot, because there's some things coming. And if any of you have ever wondered why your ballot is so long, it's because of this really cool thing called the Citizen Right to Initiative. That is one of the founding principles in Colorado. It has done some really good things for our state. It has brought us some really important things, some water conservation efforts that are now in our state constitution, some funding for schools, roads, and bridges, and it brought us 301. Unfortunately, that coin has two sides. It has also brought us some other things, such as having to have a full vote of the people every time the legislature wants to raise their budget by more than, I want to say 0.1%, is that correct, Representative? But, and so that is why our ballot for 2018 is already starting to get fairly long. So I want to highlight three things on to look for on the ballot. First, Initiative 97. And go ahead and go to the next slide. Logic is really excited to stand with Colorado Rising as well as a number of our neighborhood groups in supporting the 2,500 foot setback and Initiative 97. It is one of the most important things that we can do in terms of protecting Colorado communities from oil and gas development and protecting health, safety, and welfare. All of that said, I get the fun job of talking a little bit of doom and gloom, and then I'll tell you why there's hope. Next slide. There are a set of initiatives that the Farm Bureau and the Colorado Oil and Gas Association are currently collecting signatures for. It is initiatives 108 through 113. These are constitutional initiatives that effectively say that no government entity in Colorado has the right to restrict any use of any private property. What they do, and for the lawyers in the room, this is really fun, they effectively fully expand the definition of private property and the definition of damages. What that means for the rest of us is it means that all of a sudden local governments and the state government no longer have any ability to issue any sort of land use planning or zoning regulations. So we're not just talking oil and gas right next door, we're talking adult stores right next to schools. We're talking, local governments having, and the state government having no ability to say yes or no to something based on traffic and safety. Because what will happen if any of these initiatives pass? They are very deceptive. Because what will happen is, I believe, the Supreme Court will have to open up its own little civil division. Because everybody will sue everybody. There have been a couple of municipal attorneys that have looked at these initiatives and said what happens, and the advice that will be given to every municipal and state level government entity in the state is, don't do anything anymore. Because if you say yes, somebody's property is getting damaged and you will get sued. If you say no, somebody's property is getting damaged and you will get sued. Now, one of the things about these initiatives that we know is happening is that we know that they are gathering paid signatures. If you go to the next slide, they are gathering signatures. And they are telling people that this is about protecting your property value. Again, these are deceptive initiatives. The next set of initiatives I want to tell you about are initiatives 178 to 181. And those were filed by Vital for Colorado, who they call themselves the community arm of oil and gas. The language is going to look a little familiar. Again, they're deceptive. They start off saying health and safety first, and local government should protect health and safety. But your local government can't prohibit access or inhibit access to private property, i.e. minerals. Again, these initiatives are deceptive. Logic has filed the challenge on both initiatives. We filed it at the title board, and then we filed it at the Supreme Court level. The first set of initiatives are out of the Supreme Court and they are gathering signatures. This set of initiatives, they had their petitions approved this week. We still have them in court. We believe they will begin gathering paid signatures as well. Couple of things about these initiatives. For the little bit that folks have said that the COGCC does do, the interesting thing about these initiatives is they're written in such a way that the COGCC, for the little bit of regulation it does do, gets preempted as well. So any regulation you do have will be subject to lawsuit. So why do I have hope? We expect that the oil and gas industry will spend millions of dollars on these initiatives. Tons of millions, to be very frank. We know that they have a war chest of $3.2 million for these initiatives now. However, they need about 3,500 signatures per Senate district to make the ballot because they have filed constitutional amendments. The second piece of them is they need at least 55% of the vote in the state of Colorado. Again, it will cost tens of millions. I don't want to understate how important it is that you decline to sign, and that that folks really push to vote or have folks vote no on this initiative. I don't want to understate how important that is. It's important because if these do pass, it will require a vote of the people by 55% to change anything about them. That said, I want to close with a little bit of hope, because what I can tell you, what Dan told you, we've watched this community make the difference when it comes to oil and gas. We've watched this community change the conversation around oil and gas. Your voice is what makes the difference. 301, as Lori said, was outspent at least 10 to 1. We watched as they dusted off good old Governor Bill Owens, who suddenly became a Broomfield concerned resident that other Broomfield citizens were going to, quote, divide us. But this community went ahead. This community said, you know what? Health, safety, and welfare first is the priority in this community. And you passed that initiative. The second thing I want to tell you about is a little thing at the legislature, because Representative Foote has been a champ and has been in the trenches for a long time. For long enough, I remember when it was just Representative Foote and Senator Jones who were standing up there saying, we're going to run legislation and push this. Well, one of the reasons Logic was formed was to make sure that legislators were hearing from impacted citizens like you. And I want to say what happened this year was incredibly important. Not only did we have just a couple of bills, or we went from having just a couple of bills a few years ago to having over a dozen this year that got proposed, that got hearings, that moved through, at the very least, the State House. And Colorado legislators heard from over 200 impacted residents from around the state. And I'm going to tell you what happened. It's a little bill. And it's a little bit of progress. But I'm going to tell you, there was one group of citizens, many of whom are in this room right now, and one in particular, who ensured that a piece of legislation got passed removing the very piece that made these residents feel like they couldn't fight. So Kevin talked about forced pooling, and Sherman talked about forced pooling. One of the biggest reasons that impacted citizens have told Logic on a regular basis that they were signing leases was because they were facing operational liability. There were English professors, there were policy folks, there were all kinds of folks in different neighborhoods saying, this is our biggest concern. So we went to work on this issue. Representative Foote has been a steadfast champ for the last 8 years on this particular, or on the issue of forced pooling. His work laid the groundwork. And then a group of impacted citizens came in, and I will say, pinch hit and save the game in making sure that people who are being forced pooled are no longer subject to operational liability and can no longer become working interest owners in a company they had no interest in becoming a part of. Why is that important? In the words of the lady sitting in the front row,
this keeps us in a place where we can continue to fight and fight hard. And I will tell you, I watched as one by one members of the committee in the State House, as well as in the State Senate, heard from her and said, this lets you continue to fight, that's all I need to hear. And so Senate Bill 230 is on the governor's desk and awaiting signature. And so that is why, even though industry is gearing up to spend tens of millions of dollars, organizations like Logic, we are not a $10 million organization. We're not even a $1 million organization. We're a small fraction of that. But because of impacted citizens like you, because of your voice, you are changing the conversation, and you do have the power to make this conversation, to make oil and gas different in this state. So on that note, I want to go ahead and close by saying, let your representatives, let your local electeds hear from you. Continue to engage them in dialogue. Because the minute the conversation shuts down is the minute you lose. So continue, because what we need to let folks know, we have 55,000 wells in this state, regardless of any new wells being approved. The minute we start stop telling our elected officials health, safety, and welfare should come first, the minute we stop saying that and the minute we stop talking with them is the minute, regardless of new wells, that is the minute we lose. So, thank you.
That's it for tonight. I want to make just a few final remarks. I mean, the people who have come tonight, I really, really appreciate it. We want to ask you to really ask yourself tonight, how can you get involved? You've got a network of folks, so the people who are sitting here have reached to many, many others, and we really ask for you to figure out how you can spread the word in your community. Brimfield Concern hosts home parties, so we're happy to come to your house and have a party with wine and cheese. And make sure that we continue to engage the community. But this is an important dialogue. Number one, I want to tell you, if you're watching from home tonight, please share the video on Facebook Live. We appreciate the additional reach of that. And we hope that all of you have really enjoyed the forum. You've been informed and you've been educated about the critical issues that are facing this community. As Thomas Jefferson advised us, whenever the people are well-informed, they can be trusted with their own government. Remember, you don't have to be an expert in order to be involved. If you feel strongly about the health and safety of this community and you want our environment to be protected, your voice can and should be heard. There are many ways that you can become involved. It's especially important to let your elected officials know your views, as they make major decisions that affect the well-being of our community. This is the governor, members of Congress, and the state legislature, and certainly your mayor and city council members. They need to hear from you. And this is an important election year. You should be sure you are registered to vote and then educate yourselves on the candidates that are running for office. There are races for U.S. Congress, and at the state level, governor, attorney general, secretary of state, treasurer, and the state senate and house of representatives. Here in Broomfield, next year, we will have new city council elections. Our city council matters. Find out which candidates are aligned with your priorities and support them in every way possible. Your involvement in the political process is critical to making democracy work. And finally, the struggle for environmental justice and for the goal of assuring the protection of our planet against the ravages of industrial degradation and pollution will not be won quickly, nor will it be won easily. Just as in other great causes, such as civil rights and labor and women's rights, we must stay engaged for the long haul. We will prevail if we speak out and we never give up. Thank you so much for coming.